ocean content in mesophytes and sporophytes across land plants. So I think probably everybody or almost everybody in this room is familiar with some version of a figure that looks like this, showing the land plant life cycle. So we've got our haploid gametophyte generation here that alternates with the diploid sporophyte generation. And if we think about these generations or stages of the life cycle across land plants, we know that there's a shift from gametophyte dominance to sporophyte dominance that occurs at this point in the phylogeny, the ancestry of the tracheophytes. And this shift from gametophyte dominance to sporophyte dominance is accompanied by increases in morphological complexity in the sporophytes and decreases in morphological complexity in the gametophytes. So in these pictures of the bryophyte lineages down here, most of the tissue that you see is the gametophytes, with the exception of the hornworts, where you can see a bunch of sporophytes. And then here you're seeing pictures of the gametophytes in these lineages, in the tracheophytes. So in the lycophytes and the ferns, the gametophytes are still multicellular, pretty charismatic. They can be photosynthetic, though they're not always. But we have a really big reduction in size in the seed plants, down to gametophytes that are just a few cells in size. And this shift has been accompanied by a number of transitions in the evolutionary history of land plants. So we have changes in body plan, in physiology, physiological ecology, nutrient status, reproductive strategies. And so for this section of the 1KP project, these are the questions that we're primarily focused on to try to tease apart the differences that we see in all of these transitions. So I'm going to focus on the first two today. So thinking about percentages of genes that are present just in gametophytes, just in sporophytes, versus in both of those stages, and whether those genes appear to be particular associated with any particular functions. And then down the road, we're hoping to look at selection and whether it seems to operate differently on genes that are expressed only in one or the other phase of the life cycle. And finally, eventually, we will look at regulatory networks and ask those same types of questions for the two generations separately, versus the genes that are found in both. So our sampling plan is focused essentially on the lineages that sort of bracket this shift in dominance, and that's primarily the seed-free lineages, so the bryophytes, ferns, and we actually don't have any lycophytes in the data that I'll be presenting today, mostly because their gametophytes are extremely difficult to get. So we're limited in our sampling in that we need both gametophyte and sporophyte generation for these analyses, obviously. And in some of these groups, gametophytes are challenging to get. In others, like the bryophytes, the sporophytes can be challenging to get. So I'm going to show you data for 8 or 9 taxa today, but we do have a number of others in progress. Ideally, we're trying to get these pairs from the same species, or in a number of cases you'll see today, either from the same genus or, less ideally, from distantly related genera. But we have a number of things that are in progress right now, and thank you to GAIN for letting us expand our sampling of this, where we'll have a number of things coming down the pipeline that are gametophytes and sporophytes from the same species. We also have a special focus on ferns in this data set that I want to mention. I'm not going to be showing any of those data today because they're largely still in progress. A number of the people who've been working on this particular project have personal research interests in ferns, including myself. And I just wanted to show this figure to give you an idea of some of the diversity of morphology in fern gametophytes. So even in the fern community, gametophytes have been largely ignored for a long time, although that's thankfully changing, thanks to the efforts of this guy. He's a professor at Colgate University in New York. And these different morphologies that you see, we've got our typical sort of cordiform or heart-shaped gametophytes, strap-shaped, ribbon-shaped, and they're correlated with a lot of really interesting characters in ferns. So eventually we'll have enough data that we can address that in a lot more detail. So what I'm going to be showing you today, I'm going to move to the results that we have so far, and this is all very preliminary. But I wanted to give you just a sort of snapshot view of the data that we do have so far. So what I'm going to be showing you here, we're going to be looking across to start off with the cross rows, and I'm going to be showing you the results of single linkage clustering analyses. And so for each row, which is going to be a taxon set of a gametophyte and sporophyte, what I did was to pool those assemblies of the gametophyte and sporophyte and then do a single linkage clustering analysis. And so what you're going to see in the center are going to be clusters of genes that had members from both stages of the life cycle. And over here will be clusters of genes that only included gametophytic genes, and here will be clusters that only included sporophytic genes. And we'll go row by row through these. And the percentage numbers will be the larger ones, and then this will be the numbers of gene clusters. So first we'll start with our ferns, with bias towards ferns, so we'll start there. So we had 3 comparisons, and these were all from species within the same genus, so 2 Vitaria, 2 Ethereum, 2 this comparison here, the gametophyte sample is from a species that only ever makes a gametophyte. It actually doesn't make a sporophyte. So that might be what's driving this relatively higher percentage of clusters that only have gametophytic genes, for example. So that's kind of cool. So hornworts, it's next, and remember there's no lycophytes, unfortunately, in this data set. So for the hornworts, the numbers differ somewhat. So we see that there's a, compared to the ferns at least, there's a somewhat lower percentage of those clusters that actually included genes from both phases of the life cycle. And then we've got, particularly in this comparison, a relatively high percentage of clusters that had gametophytic-only genes. In this case, that might be because this is a more divergent comparison that we're making. So when we have more data, hopefully we'll be able to say more about this and to see what the pattern is that emerges, whether this or this is more representative of hornworts. Here we've got mosses. This is a really bizarre one right here. So this is a paired sample from the same species where we have very, very few, very small numbers of clusters that are either gametophytic only or sporophytic only. So that's also really curious. We need to think a little bit more about what might be going on in that taxon. This comparison here, where we've got 57%, which is actually the lowest, I think, in any of these clusters, 57% of clusters that had members of both life stages, this is a really distant set of genera. So Buxbaumia is sister to a large set of the mosses. And so this is a really distant comparison that we're making, which might also be contributing to some of the numbers that we're seeing here. And then finally, we have one liverwort sample in here, which actually looks fairly similar to the fern. So about 95% of the gene clusters contained both sporophytic and gametophytic genes. So I don't have time to say more about these numbers, but if you want to know more about them or if you want to see the data, please let me know. I'd be happy to talk about them later on. And the next set of analyses that I want to show you, you're going to have to shift your brain from horizontal to vertical. So we've been reading across these rows, but next what I'm going to do is look at comparisons that have pooled all of the gametophyte samples. So that looks like this. So now the comparison we're making is I've pooled all of those gametophyte samples, but I'm looking at clusters that are from gametophyte-dominant lineages versus sporophyte-dominant lineages. So this is essentially comparing ferns to the bryophyte stem here. So ferns are sporophyte dominant, so these are the genes from the gametophyte samples of the sporophyte dominant lineage. And here, not surprisingly, we see sort of an opposite pattern. So there's a relatively small percentage of all these gene clusters that contain members from the gametophytes, both the gametophyte dominant and sporophyte dominant lineages. So a high percentage of the clusters are contain genes only from sporophyte dominant taxa, and another relatively high percent contain genes only from bryophytes, from gametophyte dominant taxa. So to get at the question about function and what these genes might be doing, I'm going to show you some heat maps. So if you're not familiar with these, they can be a little bit tricky to understand. So essentially, so I'll take a minute to explain this. So what you're looking at here is for this cluster, this set of genes, all of the genes that went into this 14.1 set of gene clusters, I took all of those and ran them through an annotation pipeline to get the GO functional categories. So for that set of genes, this column adds up to 100% of their GO annotations. So you see that these categories down here, and these are the 44 really high-level GO categories, these are have very low representation in that data set. So this is like Golgi apparatus, receptor binding or activity down here at the bottom. And if you added up these very small ones, and then we get up to eventually the one with the most representation is other cellular processes at 10.3%. And frustratingly, all of the ones that do interesting things are all in either other or unknown categories. So I apologize in advance for that. But if you added up this whole column, you would get 100% of the annotations for that set of genes. So that is the set that includes genes from both gametophyte dominant and sporophyte dominant lineages. So now let me add in on the sides, this is the set of genes just from gametophyte dominant lineages down here, and this is the set from sporophyte dominant lineages. So this set up here, and keep in mind these are all gametophyte samples at this point, but from divided up according to these different lineages. So there's a few things that stand out, so I'll just highlight a couple of these. So first, the plastid category is here, and what this means essentially is that these two side columns are colored the same way as the central one is. So essentially, these guys have much lower representation than that least gives us a place to start to look at some of these categories of genes and dig in deeper and see what some of them might be doing that are a little bit different. Kinase activity is one that I have highlighted here, where the number, the percentages that we see in the two separate sets of lineages are actually higher than in this central column that has genes for both. So that's kind of interesting. And ribosome is, again, another one that, not surprisingly, is lower. So I'm just going to quickly show you the same comparison for the sporophyte samples. And so again, up here, these are the sporophyte dominant taxa. Here we have the gametophyte dominant taxa. And then this is the percent of genes that includes, or the percent of clusters that includes genes from both taxon sets, just for the sporophyte samples. And actually, the patterns that we see are quite similar. So again, we've got plastid, kinase activity is doing the same thing, ribosome is doing the same thing. So there are some shifts in the relative percentages of some of those categories, and so we'll be looking at those genes in more detail. But it is interesting that a number of the same patterns do emerge in the sporophyte samples that we saw in the gametophyte samples. So again, I'd be happy to talk more about these data if anybody is interested in doing that later on. And I just wanted to return to this slide, which was showing the questions that we're interested in. So I've covered these in a little bit of detail today. And again, we'll be looking at selection and in regulatory network structure down the line. And we're really interested in expanding sampling of all of these lineages. Obviously, I showed you a very small set of comparisons today that can't really represent all of what's going on in each of these lineages. So we're hoping to add lycophytes by the end of this summer, maybe including seed plant gametophytes at some point would also be great. So we'll keep working on this data set to include more taxa from all of these things. So I'd like to also thank all of the sponsors and everybody who's been involved with 1KP. And I'd also just like to add that a number of additional collectors and organizations contributed gametophyte samples or spores for this section of the project, including all those folks here. And a lot of the growing of those things was done in my lab, so I'd just like to acknowledge them.